So this presentation is about living data. Fantastic. Take it away, Lisa.
Thanks, Claire.
Hello, everybody. Firstly, I acknowledge the traditional custodians of this land on which we meet and pay my respects to elders past, present and future. I acknowledge the support of UTS for my contribution to this conference. I'm a visual artist and interactive author. I interact with scientists, artists and other scholars to co-author stories that come from scientific data and Indigenous cultural knowledge. Like many Australians with European and Aboriginal Australian ancestry, I am dispossessed of knowledge of my traditional lands and languages and strive to reconnect the different ways of knowing that together sustained Aboriginal Australia for tens of thousands of years. Since working as an artist in Antarctica, I recognise Antarctic krill, Euphausia superba, as my totem. And as I strive to understand this keystone creature, I learn about the Southern Ocean as the ecosystem that drives natural cycles of climate change worldwide. So, my perspectives are Antarctic, Australian, Indigenous, and global. Today I present with UTS scientist Ellery Johnson. Together we will show how we work with people around the world to combine our perspectives to build an animated interactive map, to reconnect science and art with Indigenous cultural knowledge that has for too long been missing from reports to the International Panel for Climate Change, the IPCC. The premise of our work is that just as people process information in different ways, so the different languages of art can convey scientific data in ways best remembered when people can relate the data to personal experience and then pass on their understanding as art in all its forms. This is an Indigenous approach to education that is available to everyone. I begin by explaining the background, methods, and results of our work to map and identify stories in ways of knowing described by Indigenous scholar Tyson Yunker Porter as minds that work together to create a holistic view. We show ways of telling stories that expand understanding of scientific data, thereby expanding the sources of knowledge as fundamental to accurate, long-lived communications and robust decisions. Background. Scientific data and Indigenous cultural knowledges indicate that all lands and waterways are connected. In line with the strong movement towards recognising place-based knowledge and connection to country, and the central role of the Southern Ocean in regulating global ecosystems, we are collecting stories along the path of the ocean currents from Antarctica to all other areas to express the significance of the linkages around the world of the effect of climate change. Ancient and new technologies are explored to understand connectivity in natural systems, with stories informed by Indigenous knowledge and the scientific method. Our methods build on the success of the 2018 Lens on Health Roundtable event for National Science Week at UTS. Guided by Wiradjuri scholar Megan Williams, everyone was welcomed, introduced, and engaged as we told our stories of relationship to Aboriginal Australia. We then engaged through the arts with the science of connectivity in nature. Everyone had something to teach and something to learn. In 2020, co-authors of this paper met for roundtable discussions via Zoom. Facilitated by Antarctic scientist Andrew Constable, we came from different countries and disciplines to co-author a paper that would engage policymakers in the scientific data of Southern Ocean health through a range of perspectives. Acknowledging that people think in different ways, stories are collected, composed and identified according to ways of knowing described by Tyson Yunker Porter as minds that work together to give a holistic view. Kinship mind, story mind, dreaming mind, ancestor mind, and pattern mind. And to enable active ways to engage with the stories online, creature avatars are being created for people to play with and imagine themselves being part of the stories told. Between us, we wrote and prepared material to seed the evolving online MISO living data map, and this link was embedded in the paper. Animations were made that trace scientific data, and drawings and gestures that people make as they tell their stories. Music and poetry were made in response and fed back into the project. One such story is told by Ellery's Drawings in Sand. Drawings in Sand bring to life his knowledge from scientific data of disruptions to natural flows in an estuarine environment where a river meets the sea.
My name is Ellery Johnson. I am an aquatic ecologist at UTS. I first met Lisa at the 2017 AFSS Cultural Water Symposium and have worked with her on several projects since, including the paper she is outlining today. During that time, I have begun to incorporate some principles of Indigenous knowledge sharing into my work. While not an artist, I have found that engaging with art as a communicative tool has helped me to understand my science better and communicate it more strongly. This is a short communication I have made about the findings of some research undertaken during my thesis. Estuaries depend on freshwater inflows to regulate them ecologically. Their health is not just dictated by their internal water quality, but also their connections to the surrounding catchment. As freshwater inflows transport resources to estuaries, preventing them may have ecological consequences. With the transport of organic matter and nutrients downstream to estuaries by inflows, algal and microbial growth is stimulated. A key organism in transporting these food web resources through the food web are these zooplankton called copepods. I have found that in an unregulated estuary with natural flows, seasonal temperature, algal growth, and adult copepod populations are all correlated. However, in a disrupted system with reduced flow, I found that seasonal temperature, algal growth, and adult copepod populations did not correlate. While the mechanisms driving these differences are not fully known, freshwater inflows seem to be a key to the ecological health of estuaries.
IT engineer Kat Kutai has begun to develop the map and online portals for collecting and displaying stories, and enabling people to feed back into the project to share and grow knowledge. I have begun to develop the Living Data Library as a repository for feeding into the map and for presenting as a touchscreen interactive installation and online. Animations are co-created and geolocated to enable people to physically and viscerally connect with regions other than those they inhabit, and increase awareness of global values and issues from different sources of knowledge. Stories continue to be collected along the path of the ocean currents from Antarctica to all other areas to express the significance of the linkages around the world of the effect of climate change. Traditional and contemporary cultural arts can show connectivity in nature in ways that bring to life data from the scientific method and show the difference between historical, natural, environmental phenomena and current changes and disruptions to existing ecosystems.
Hello. Thanks, Lisa and Ellery, that was amazing. Are we going to open the floor for questions?
Yes, please.
All right. Yeah, fantastic. Really interesting perspective to think about looking through a different lens at science as we know it today. I think it's fantastic in an otherwise fairly kind of structured field. So has anyone got any questions? I'll run the microphone around.
Yeah, I don't think it's not so much a question. I just think that this is innovation and how you can bring Western science and cultural science together. Collaboration, and you know, if we're thinking about recording this connectivity and this symbiotic way of life and how we interact with our cultural landscapes, I think this is just a fantastic option that should give us the opportunity to broaden our minds and the way we think about recording and presenting, particularly to the future generations that we all want to influence to be the next environmental scientist, biologist, you name it. So I just want to commend you both on a wonderful, wonderful product. I think that's amazing. So Moree, we just thank you.
Thanks, Uncle Phil. Any more questions, comments, any detractors?
I got a comment.
Here we go, he's in.
I like the coping pot that appeared out of all that interactions with the team. I grew up on coping pots, and so it was something special for me.
What did that taste like, Brian?
Crunchy.
No, it's certainly something. I'm not artistic at all. I think I dropped art as soon as I could, but to go back and do simple drawings with much more loaded messaging within them, I thought was a really powerful tool that I'm coming together to learn more. But yeah, I think the important thing is it can be integrated across so many different cultures. I mean, three wavy lines is basically a symbol for water wherever you go. So yeah, it was really interesting to do that. And we had people across the world. We had people from Tierra del Fuego involved and people from New Zealand. So it was really excellent to do that.
Any more questions, comments? Yes.
Thanks for your presentation. So you said before that you've been working with a wide variety of cultures, and that obviously means that you're probably working with people in different countries and different levels of government and different ways of managing larger populations. Have you found that incorporating your Indigenous perspective into science and hard fields like that has actually had a benefit for recognition in those respective places? Or is it more like almost a tokenistic kind of approach where incorporating into science is fantastic, but not seeing change in policy writing and things like that isn't happening? Have you encountered anything like that?
It's a complex response, and I really appreciate it. This is a complex situation. Can you hear me? This is working. I think what we're... Okay, yes. We met via Zoom with scholars around the world. And the key point of connection for us all was recognition that we all have Indigenous ancestry if you go back far enough. And this is the quest of many people now who want to find ways to give meaning to their scientific data. And I think you said it best, Alan, isn't it? Your name's Alan.
Brian.
Sorry, Brian. That coping pot was what gave meaning, most meaning to you. I don't expect everybody in the room to understand everything that we just showed you, because that's come from a whole lot of different people who each have a different perspective. But there's just something about the Indigenous cultural arts around the world that is different from Western art that I grew up with, which is very much a commodity. It's about selling stuff. It's often used for propaganda of a particular worldview, and it's often about naming and claiming land. This is my perspective. I'm the great-granddaughter of Tom Roberts, the colonial artist. So that's just my lifetime experience of what art is. And since studying at Eora College in Sydney, I've opened up to a much broader understanding of what the arts why we make art. It's to connect ourselves to the land, to listen to the land, respond, and to connect with other people in that way. So I didn't experience any tokenism whatsoever. It was a tricky process coming together and meeting to do this. And it's in for peer review in a scientific journal, so we'll see how we go.